Thank you to be here today. So, in my presentation, I will talk about a simple problem, simply to explain but difficult to solve, which is named auto-verification. And basically, auto-verification is part of the domain called authorship analysis. So we try to find or to identify authors in textual documents. And auto-verification is pretty simple. We have an unknown textual document, and we want to know if the target author is the author of the document or not. So it's a kind of binary classification, it's yes or not. It's much more difficult than another problem in authorship analysis, which is referred as authorship attribution. Because in authorship attribution, we have a closed set of author, and we have a new document, and we want to know which author is in its closed set is the author of the document. Here we have like an open problem. So, and this kind of analysis is very important in a lot of different fields. Like in computer security, you can not only apply this to textual documents, but also to code source, to source code, to identify authors of computer viruses. We have a lot of application forensic and law. Sometimes the law enforcers want to know if someone under investigation is the author of an arson message, for example, or if you want to get some evidence to go on a trial. And there's a lot of application in literature. For example, we have a lot of uncertainty about some plays of Shakespeare. But a good example is 2 years ago, there is a good identification of a famous Italian writer named Elena Ferrante. Everybody, it's a pseudonym, so we don't know who is the true author behind Elena Ferrante. But everybody was saying it's a woman, because it's very the language she used is very like the language used by women. So in fact, 2 years ago there was a group of scientists, and we got a good evidence that in fact Elena Ferrante is a man. Is a famous Italian writer named Stallone. So everybody was wrong on that. So we have a lot of application on this field, but we have the work since now in authorship verification was done on very not simple but very structured documents, like on novels, on single author documents. So we have only one author, but today we have. With the social networks era, we have a lot of a stream of text. We have a lot of textual data where you cannot put beginning and an end. It's not one author, it's multi-author documents. Some authorship can change very fastly between like one tweet or the other. We have a lot of need to handle this data, like in fake news, in social network, to identify who is the author of fake news, if a tweet is generated by the bots or something like this. So we need a new kind of natural language processing systems that are able not just to take very documents as a block, but very take data as a stream of text. Okay. So what I wanted to do in these studies was to train some model, a very simple neural network model, which is the first time it's used in a natural language processing. It's a very simple model, and we need for that we need a model which is able to take the order of the words. Okay. And we need to model which recurrent neural network model which are named many to many. So at each step, we want a probability of autorship. So for the data set, we had the chance some years ago the issue of two science fiction magazine, old science fiction magazine, was made public on the internet by archive.org. And then I took two of these magazines, which the first one is Galaxy Science Fiction and Eve Science Fiction. And I took 91 issues of these two magazines, published between 1952 and 1974. And all these old magazines was digitalized by optical character recognition. But it was done 2 years ago, so it was not done using deep learning, LSTM, state-of-the-art, OCR. So we have a lot of word misidentification, so we have very noisy textual data. So for each issue, for the whole data set, we have knowing, looking at the content of the table of contents, we know that we have more than 1,000 authors who contribute to these documents. And in the document, in the model, we process only all the documents of just raw text coming from the OCR. And so you have example here of the two magazines, which are very old-fashioned science fiction magazines. And from this dataset of 91 issues, I took three different authors. The first one is the famous science fiction writer Isaac Asimov. He's very well known for the three laws of robotics. You have a lot of debate about artificial intelligence. If you're going to debate today, at one point someone will quote the three laws of robotics of Isaac Asimov. He's well known. There is some adaptation in movies. There is iRobot with Will Smith. The second author is Philip K. Dick, a very prolific author. There is some adaptation like Blade Runner, I think everybody knows that. Total Recall also, with Schwarzenegger. So it's Hollywood is a huge fan of this author. There's a lot of adaptation. And the last one is a very, very prolific author named Robert Zweigbergk, which is not as famous as the first two, but he was very prolific. He wrote like hundreds of novels in the science fiction magazines. So you have an example here with Isaac Asimov. So it's a comment page of one of his novels. So inside the issue, you have like different parts written by different authors. So you have here parts written by Asimov, but you have illustration just in the middle. But at the beginning, you have like the table of contents, you have ads, you have parts written by the editor, you have the reader's letters. So you have a lot of different authors and a lot of different parts with different characteristics. And what we want to do in authorship attribution, in authorship verification, is to find which part is written by the target author. Okay, so we have another example here with a bigger illustration. So it's a part written by Robert Zweigbergk, and you have that's an example of illustration. But in some illustration, you have like text, or you have in all this noisy input can be very difficult for the OCR. So in the raw text, you have like the text written by the author, and then you have ads very badly recognized by the OCR, so it's just random character. And so the model has to be able to identify each part and to go over this very noisy text stream. So we have, at the end, for each author, we have, for Asimov, we have 22 issues. For Philip K. Dick, we have 25, and we have much more issue with Zilda, with 45. for a total of 8 million won. Okay, for a total of in the 91 issues. So we have a big, much bigger data set for Silverberg, which he wrote 11% of the whole data set. So you don't have like a document, the document you don't have like a single author. In some issue you have novels written by Asimov and a novel written by Silverberg. Okay, so I trained different models for each author. Okay, and over the year, so we have in the 50s, in the 60s, and in the 70s, so we have basically Asimov with approximately the same kind, the same number of textual documents over the year, but like for Philip K. Dick, we have like only documents between the 50s and the 60s. We have no documents in the 70s. And you can see that Silverberg is very productive over the year. One question is maybe what I choose these authors. The first point is because they are very famous. We have a lot of text, we have a lot of data, and they are not known to use pseudonyms, because it's one of the main points in author verification in literature, is to identify pseudonyms. Here we just take a more simple data set where we can be sure of the training data. Okay? So the model is a recurrent network that we call EchoStep networks. So maybe you're used to LSTM, long short-term memory, and gate recurrent units. And this one is much more simple. The idea behind the EchoStep network, which is I know referred as reservoir computing, is that you have a part that we call, it's the recurrent part that we call the reservoir. And the reservoir is created randomly. All the connection is done randomly. The input, the connection from the input to the reservoir is also created completely randomly. The only part which is affected by training is the output. And we do not use very more complicated training procedure like backpropagation, gradient descent. You can just use very simple linear regression training on this part. And the idea behind this is that it looks pretty strange that, okay, we just take a bunch of neurons and we connect them randomly and that's okay. And in fact, it's working very well in practice. It's very fast to train and you don't need a lot of data compared to LSTM or GRU. Okay, so the input layer here, the number of units depends on the textual representation that we use. And at the output, we have only one output, which is the estimated probability. And what we do is that we fill in the tokens, one token at a time. And at the end, the target training signal is zero when the text is not written by the target author, and one when the text is written by the target author. Okay? And the methodology behind that is first we use a training set to train the model. We then use a validation set to find a threshold. So we use one-class learning, so we try to find a threshold that is the best threshold to separate the two classes, so the class not written by the author and the class written by the author. And then when we have the best optimal threshold, we use the test set to evaluate the model. So we have a first task. The first task is basically we want to know in a document, so in one issue of the magazine, we want to know which part is written in the stream of text at each point, which part is written by the target author. So for example, for Asimov, we want to know in a magazine at which point it's a text written, it's a novel written by Asimov. The second task, it's simpler. We just want to know in the collection which document is a collaboration with Asimov, for example, with Asimov or with the target author. So we just want to take, we do not want to know which part is written by the author, we just want to know if there is a collaboration inside. Okay? And for this we use then five-fold cross-validation with 80% for the training, 10% for the validation to find the threshold, and 10% for the evaluation. I did that for the three authors using the F1 score, and I compute the average F1 score for the three authors. Okay? But first, when I feed the token inside the recurrent neural network, I need to transform the text into a representation. This kind of model is very powerful for time series prediction or time series classification. So I need to transform the text into a time series. For this, I choose two representations. The first is the word embedding layer. So it's pre-trained embedding layer using GLOV with a little bit more than 1 million words in the dictionary. And then we have, for each token, we have a vector of dimension 300. If when it comes out of the vocabulary, we just put zero, we just put the new vector. The second representation is named C3, so it's a character 3 glance representation. I trained a basic feed-forward neural network with an input embedding layer, and the feed-forward neural network has to predict the token, the frequency of characters from its context. I trained that on Wikipedia, on the dataset extracted from Wikipedia, and on 230 million examples. Okay, and from that I then took the embedding layer and I used that as the input of the ESM. And that's what you got when you run the ESM, train ESM on the two exam documents. So this is the x-axis is the token index, so it could be words or character frequency. Is the output of the ESM, which is normalized, and you have the part in blue, which is the text written by the target author. Okay, so you have in red is for the first task, so it's the task where we want to identify which part is written by the target author. So you have here like the threshold, and you can see that just above the threshold, all the points are classified as belonging to the part written by the target author. Okay? The red, so for the first time task, the green points are for the second task. So in the second task, we just want to know if the documents contain the text written by the author. So what we do is that we draw a threshold. And if we find points above this threshold, we just say, okay, this is enough evidence. There is a text written by this author, and we don't try to get more evidence about that. Okay? So you have one good example. Here, you have a very clear threshold to identify which the part written by the authors. And the more difficult one, here, so the part is very clear, but you have a lot of different parts which are misidentified. But the threshold for the second part is very good. One problem with this model is that the output of the neural network is very unstable. So it looks very good sometimes because we have a clear difference between the parts written by the author or not. But in fact, we have you have to find a good threshold without knowing how the outputs behave. And that's one of the problems, because the output of ESN is not bounded. It's not like the STM when you can put a sigmoid function at the end. So it's maybe one of the main points for future research is to use more powerful methods to have more to have more stable outputs, or to find a better solution to find the better threshold. Okay, if we check at the stream level, so we want to identify each part in the stream, we can see we have a baseline which is basically the true classifier, so it's a classifier which always says, okay, it's belong to the part of the other. And we have the ESN with word representation and Cartesian representation for each three authors and the average. And you can see that basically the ESN based on three grams of characters are not much better, but better. Only on Kadik, there is equal performance. But we can see that Kadik is very easy to identify, even if we have, it's easier to identify than Sibelberg, even if we have, like, basically much more data for Sibelberg. So there is maybe something about Philip Kadik, which is maybe he has very specific style compared to Sibelberg, which is maybe more common. And on the second task, we have here then with the same true classifier. So this time is for the document. We're going to know only at the document level if there is a text inside written by each author. As baseline, we have this time the SVR, so it's a regression based on support vector machines. I tested different baseline, and this one was the it was not very, it's not to be honest the best, because I tried different design and the performance was not better than the random classifier for this kind of models. So basically the method is exactly the same as for the ESL. We have a training set. I trained the SVR on the training set. I use a classification, the validation set to get the optimal threshold, and I test the performance on the test set. Okay, if we compare our model, the ESM model and each representation to the baseline, we can see that even at the document level, the character 3-gram representation is the best. Only for Sibelberg, we have equal performance. We can see that the SVR basically is not better than the random classifier. So for the future work, it will be useful to get maybe more complex baseline. Like we have a good method with sliding windows to identify more parts. But the difference between the SVR model and the ESM is that basically it's not a recurrent model. So even if you have here an identification of the author, you don't know you don't have evidence, because you don't have which position the model base its prediction. Okay? Compared to the ESN, we can, if we have documented, we say, okay, this document, there is a part written by Asimov. You can take the green point, which I call index point, and you can say, okay, this document, there is a cloud version by Asimov, and I can give you a part of the text which is typical of this model. So I can get evidence of my classification. One reason I don't have more baseline here is that basically, maybe in the future, I will work on LSTM and GRU, but most of the classical methods in authorship analysis, we cannot take all the documents as a block. So we don't have a many to many model. Okay, so here I need very specific model. What thing we can do then is that with output we can just take some parts with very high output probabilities. And then you can say, okay, this text is very representative, very typical of the author. So you have here three different three texts which are very very high probability of the output. The first one is Isaac Asimov, and what we can see is that Isaac Asimov is very specific because he's talking about a lot about science, technology. So he was a science fiction writer, but he was very educated in science. He got a PhD in chemistry. And so he's talking a lot about technology and science. So we have a lot of very specific vocabulary of this one. So this one is extracted from the Broad Tale itself, which marked 1972. Philip K. Dick used much longer sentences. And Philip K. Dick is very... he's writing a lot about very specific topic like time travel, shifting realities, reality with reality which are not really existing. So we have like a style which are very fancy and with a lot of very large vocabulary which is very very easy to identify. And Robert Simmelberg, this one is very specific because it used the point of view from the reader, so we have a lot of I, of me, and so on. And I cannot tell you a lot about the style of Robert Simmelberg because I'm not I did not read a lot of science fiction novels about. Of conversation. So, but we can see that Robert Simmelberg is also easy to identify by human eye, even if we have more data. But as you can see on the outputs and on the results, Philip Kadek is the easier to identify. In the future, as I say, I would like to use more powerful model, like more short-term memory. We can see in the result that it's a challenge that it's accessible by very simple models like ESM. So you can imagine what we can do with very powerful model like STM. And we have more data, we have more than 80 billion words. Maybe the problem here is that you have to go ahead to create the dataset. I had to go into all the issues of the magazine, and I had to go to the table of contents and to tag each starting point and ending point. That's the reason why I had only 91 issues. But at the end, we have basically 80 balls with a little bit more bigger datasets. Maybe we can use other kind of representation like partial speech, and we can work on other kind of dataset like Twitter, Facebook, and so on. So we can apply this technology directly on the web to identify other articles. That's all for now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nils. So I have short time for one or two questions. Yes.
Question about echo state networks. So if I understood correctly, the weights in the reservoir are not updated?
No.
So can you give some intuition why this still is a good idea to, or how, why does it work?
Basically, the idea is that by creating a random reservoir, you create the state of the ecostate network is the result of the history of the input signal. And by that way, you create a rich set of representation. And we can, it's really strange that at the beginning you were like, maybe it's a little bit strange because we used two very powerful methods where you go back in time, through time, to hold the weight. And in fact, we just hold this random representation, we can get very good performance. There's a lot of work about this theoretical question. I will publish a paper next month about all the hyperparameters because there is different hyperparameters between. And there is a lot of paper about why it is working. But it goes down deep into chemical system, even physics, and so on. So it's not a question, it's a question that needs
another question, yeah?
If you're looking at a whole bunch of texts from over 20 years, right, if I remember correctly,
from
the 50s all the way up to the 70s, now all authors changed their style dramatically over time, but Isaac Asimov is really well known for that, because if you look at the Foundation novels back in the 50s, the style was completely different from what he ended up doing in the 70s, like the guys themselves. So did you study that aspect in your work?
No, I did not check if there is a difference in classification between the three decades. But yeah, that's a point, is to to use that technology to see if there is some change in just one of them. And that's basically in authorship analysis what we try to do, is to see how the language of one author is changing over time. Another thing is the pseudonym. We know that Asimov, we don't really use pseudonym, but that's the kind of thing we try to in the text, to see if there is at the end a text which is very similar. But we have the problem with the changing style. Because if we have a pseudonym, a text written by Asimov that's under pseudonym, if the style is very different,
thank you again, Nils.